If you have your Bibles, turn to Daniel chapter number 9 tonight. I'm going to get back into the book of Daniel, try to give you in 9, 10, 11, and 12 the high points of prophecy. I won't preach it verse by verse, but I will give you the high points of prophecy. Before you get there, I want you also to go to Galatians chapter number 4 and verse number 4. And this verse will become really real to you in the next week or two as I share this portion of scripture in the book of Daniel. And I'll come back to this later, but I want you to really remember this. Then I'll take you back to Daniel 9 and verse 20 through 27. I am going to give you the Old Testament mountain peak of prophecy tonight, where all prophecy hinges from, especially our pre-tribulation, pre-millennial belief of the coming of the Lord Jesus Christ. But I want you to notice Galatians 4. If you're there, say amen. Amen. And verse number 4, and I'm going to ask you, do you believe this? But when the fullness of the time was come, God sent forth his Son, made of a woman, made under the law, to redeem them that were under the law, that we might be receive the adoption of sons. And because ye are sons, God has sent forth the Spirit of his Son into your hearts, crying, Abba, Father. Boy, somebody ought to shout on this one. Wherefore thou art no more a servant, but a son.
Amen.
And if a son, then an heir of God through Christ. Woo! I'm a king's child. I'm an heir of God, a joint heir with Jesus. Now turn back to chapter 9 of Daniel, and we are going to discuss the mountain peak of prophecy tonight. Daniel's 70 weeks. I'm going to make a statement at the beginning of this message, and then I'm going to prove it throughout the next couple, 3 weeks. God had a predetermined time for his son to come to die at Calvary. And I want you to know this. He has a predetermined time when his son's going to come back the second time. And do you know this? That we can find it right in the Word of God. And whoop, whoop, I'm about to get happy. Look at Daniel 9. And ladies and gentlemen, when you read portions of Scripture like this, don't do this. I know folks do this when they read portions of Scripture like this. And they do this, they push what I call the panic button. They read something, then they say, whoop, I can't understand it. I want you to do this for me tonight. Don't push the panic button. Actually, this is not as deep as some of you have made it. But I'll try to help you understand it tonight. And oh good Lord, I feel some preach coming on, Brother Chad. Go with me to Daniel 9 and verse number 20. If you're there, say amen.
Amen.
Now Daniel is in the midst of praying. By the way, it's a good place to be praying.
Amen.
I tell you, in the last week, I've done a lot of praying. I've been seeking the face of God.
Yeah.
We're in the fall season. We're getting ready to push off to go to even greater things for this church. We've had one of the greatest summers we've ever had at Tate Valley Baptist Church. Had the most baptisms in a summer. We had souls saved this summer. God has done great things, but I'm going to tell you what, I believe God's ready to blast this place off, and we're going to see even greater things this fall. And we're going to give him all the glory for it. But Daniel was praying. Look what he said. And I want to interpret some scripture as I go. And while I was speaking and praying, and listen to this, and confessing my sins. Now notice this. Before you can start confessing somebody else's sin,
amen,
or even deal with somebody else's sin, you better deal with your own sin first.
Amen.
He was confessing. He said, I confess my sin. You said, you know, there's a lot of folks think they have arrived. Ladies and gentlemen, none of us have arrived. We all have sin. We all have problems. We all have issues. Daniel was no different than us. He said, I confess my sin. Then not only did he confess his sin, but being a spiritual leader, and he said, and the sin of my people Israel. Now notice, I'm going to give the key to this. I talked to you about today. If you don't get the next couple things I'm going to say right, and I'm going to show you in verse 20 and 24 the context. The context of Daniel's prophecy of his 70 weeks is not concerning the church.
Amen. Amen, preacher. It's a mystery.
No. The church wasn't revealed in the Old Testament. We've seen it in a few types. We picture it in the Song of Solomon. But the Old Testament did not picture the church. You know why the church wasn't pictured in the Old Testament? The church is a mystery.
That's right. Amen, preacher. That's exactly right.
Come on, help me. The church is a mystery.
Right.
And if you try to interpret Daniel chapter 9 in the light of the church, you are going to mess it up and mess it up bad. Somebody help me preach. And I want to go on record, and I know there's some ites out there, and you know the ones I'm talking about, that believe the church replaces Israel. Absolutely not. They believe that God's done with Israel and that we, the church, is Israel. We are not Israel. And God's not done with that nation. And this prophecy, notice what it said. He said, and the sin of my people who?
Israel.
Say it, church.
Israel.
Who's God's people in this passage?
Israel.
Okay, now do one thing for me. Go down to verse 24, then I'll pull backtrack, but go to verse 24. 70 weeks are determined upon who?
God.
Who's thy people?
Israel.
Who's my people?
Israel. Amen.
Is that proper interpretation?
Yes, sir. Amen.
Ladies and gentlemen, how in the world can you bounce the church into that? How in the world can you say the church has anything to do with it? That has nothing to do with the church. Ladies and gentlemen, I'll be talking about the 70th week of Daniel in the next couple of weeks. And the 70th week of Daniel is the tribulation period. And since the church has nothing to do with this, the church will not go through 1 minute of the tribulation period.
Praise God.
Woo! I'm getting happy at my own preaching. Lord have mercy. I got some of these knuckleheads that believe the church is going through half of the tribulation. Now there's a group, the ites, that think they go through 3/4 of the tribulation period. And then some kind of rapture. Then some of them don't even believe in a rapture. They just believe the church will go up and right back down at the end when the coming of Christ. That is false doctrine.
Amen.
Now let's stay with me. Whew. I'm coming, buddy. Just stay with me. And presenting my supplication before my Lord my God for the holy mountain of my God. Listen to this. Yea, while I was speaking in prayer, even the man Gabriel. Don't tell me that angels don't present themselves.
Amen.
As
Amen.
He said the man Gabriel.
Amen.
So he came in the fashion of a what?
Man.
Of what?
A man. Entertaining him.
You ever read the book of Hebrews where it said we entertain angels unaware? I, ladies and gentlemen, believe that you have come in contact with angels and didn't even know it, and they were sent there to protect you through some situation, somebody. And you said, who are they anyway? I'm getting bogged down. Who are they anyway? They're the ministering spirits to the heirs of salvation. God knows I'm going to be saved. And guess what? I had an angel that protected me until I got saved. Somebody ought to shout hallelujah. Just give me another week's rest and I'll climb this pulpit. Hallelujah. Yes, my Lord. Now, notice this. I'm gonna stop you a moment and don't hiss at me. Don't hiss at me. And don't disagree with me because you may be wrong. And don't make statements that you can't back up with Scripture.
Amen.
Okay? I have been told that Gabriel was an archangel. He's not. It's not told us that. I'm not saying he wasn't one of the three key angels. He was. Always bringing a message. But it doesn't say he was the archangel. There's only one archangel that is named the archangel. There's three major angels, Lucifer, Gabriel, but the only one is called the archangel, is Michael. Now, Lois, I don't want to throw out all the song books, but Gabriel was never called the archangel. Michael was. And when it says the Lord is coming with a shout and the voice of the archangel, I know that's going to destroy every song in the world, but that's not Gabriel. That voice of that archangel is Michael. And you know what's happened? We've not interpreted Scripture line upon line and precept upon precept. We've just took some philosophy of a man and heard some man say, well, there was three archangels. Well, they may have been, but I can't prove that with Scripture.
Amen.
I can only prove there's one. Huh? Do you agree? Okay. Thank you. And honestly, I'm not trying to make a big deal. I'm just trying to show you what the Word of God said. We got to interpret line upon line, precept upon precept. Listen what he said. Whom I seen in the vision at the beginning. He said, when I started this book, I saw him. Being caused to fly swiftly. Now, though he was a man, he could move quick. Touch me about the time of the evening oblation. Listen to this. Whew. And he informed me.
Praise God.
I'm praying. I'm down on my knees. And here comes the angel. And I look up. You said you was he closing his eyes? No, he wasn't closing his eyes because he was looking at the angel. And he looked up, and it was a man's face.
Amen.
And he knew who it was, Gabriel.
Amen.
Who spoke at him, and he saw him in a vision at the beginning. Now he's seen him face to face. Dear Lord God, am I getting happy? Y'all with me?
Amen.
Boy, that's awesome. And he informed me and talked with me and said, oh, Daniel, I am now come, forth to give thee skill and understanding. You know, I wish some preachers grab a hold of this. You're not as skillful as you think you are. If you get any skill and if you are able to interpret Scripture, it's because you've got the Holy Ghost or an angel interpreting for you. Amen. Whew. At the beginning of thy supplications, the commandment came forth, and I am come to show thee, for thou art greatly beloved. Every man of God in this world ought to raise their hand that's called a preacher or a messenger and raise their hand and thank God Amen. That we're beloved of God. Amen. Therefore, understand this matter and consider the vision. Now, he's going to give the vision. I want y'all, are you with me now? I know I just got 20 minutes, but we're just waiting in tonight. And then we're going to interpret this in the next 2 or 3 weeks. And I got some charts for you tonight that I passed out. They'll make it easier for you. 70 weeks are determined upon who? Say it, church. Yeah. Thy people. And upon the holy city to finish the transgression, to make an end of sins. Listen to all this, Chad. And to make reconciliation for iniquity, and to bring into everlasting righteousness, and to seal up the vision and prophecy, and to anoint the most holy. He said, I'm going to redeem you from your sin. I'm going to show you when Jesus is going to be crowned, and we're going to anoint him King of Kings and Lord of Lords. He said, and God's going to do that in 70 weeks. Now look at us interpret. Now let's go on. Know therefore and understand. Now let's see how it's going to happen. That from the going forth of the commandment to restore and to build Jerusalem. Are y'all with me? Unto Messiah the Prince shall be 7 weeks and 62 weeks. Now how many weeks is that? Say it, church. 69. The streets shall be built again, and the walls even in troublesome times. Now notice this. And after 62 weeks, we got 7, then 62 weeks, Messiah be cut off. That's Calvary, but not for himself. And the people of the prince. Now notice that. Who is the people of the prince? That's the Antichrist. That shall come, shall destroy the city and the sanctuary, and the end thereof shall be with a flood, and unto the end of the war, desolations are determined. Now notice the context. And he shall confirm. Who's the he? That's not Jesus. That's the prince. Confirm the covenant with many for 1 week. Or he's going to make a covenant with Israel for a week. In the midst of the week, he shall call the sacrifice and oblation to cease. And for the overspreading of the abominations, he shall make it desolate, even unto the consummation that determined shall be poured upon the desolate. Now, let me give you two things. And first of all, I'll give point number one. I've kind of done it in the introduction, so we'll go over it quickly. Daniel prayed to God. How many's glad you can pray to God?
Amen.
Colton, I was glad you got an answer prayer today.
Amen.
I've been praying for that. I've been praying for that. Hallelujah. And you got an answer prayer. You know why you got an answer prayer? You got a prayer answering God.
Amen.
Somebody help me. Aren't you glad you got a prayer answering God?
Yes.
Daniel prayed to God, and then God answered his prayer. He done it in an unusual way. He sent an angel and told the angel told him. Now, I've never had an angel come and tell me that I knew. But in Daniel's case, he did, Joe. Now, here's the second point, and this is what I'm going to deal with in the next 2 or 3 weeks. You're probably going to take that, because I'm going to show you Daniel. Then I'm going to show you the fulfillment of this in Revelation. I'm also going to show you Matthew 24 that's been misinterpreted also. I'll unfold all that in the next 2 or 3 weeks. But the second point tonight I want you to notice, God has a prophetic plan to bring about our salvation. How many of y'all believe that?
Amen.
How many of you believe that God had a plan?
Amen.
Do you believe God had a plan? Then what it really amazes me, that he had a plan, and some of you ought to get up and shout right here, and you're included in it.
Amen.
Did y'all get that? God had a big plan. And you're included in it. Now there's four things that we'll notice in the outline that I'll come back to, Allison. In verse 24, God is going to deal with sin. I'll give you that and I'll come back to it in a little bit. In verse 25 and 26, in his time, God sends Messiah Jesus to die on the cross. Verse 26, in his time, God judges his people. And then verse 27, in his time, God destroys his enemies. Now notice the time. What is the time, ladies and gentlemen? 70 weeks. Now hold a minute, Chad. If we're looking, how many days in a week?
Seven.
So if I took that like that, then God has his plan that was 490 days. Right? Wrong. Now I'm going to show you. Now, how many of y'all have ever heard, stay with me, I'm going somewhere. How many have ever heard the law of first mention? Raise your hand. Law of first mention. It is important in Scripture to see the law of first mention and on how they interpret Scripture. When he said, Colton, he said 70 weeks are determined for my people. Right. In that 70 weeks, Messiah's going to be cut off. We know when that was. That's 2,000 years ago. Amen. And then the Most Holy is going to be anointed. That hadn't happened yet. Right? Right? Now, stay with me. I'm coming down the line. Law of first mention. Turn to Genesis 29. First time week is mentioned. Genesis 29. And I want y'all to see how it's interpreted. Because when I do this, it's going to start making sense to you. Are y'all there? Genesis 29, and go down to verse 27 and 28. 29, 27, and 28. Are you there? How many know that Jacob's name means trickster? Well, he got a father-in-law that outdone him in trickston. He had a father-in-law named Laban. See, Jacob fell in love with a woman named Rachel. You know what Laban said? Fulfill her what?
Weak.
See, church, fulfill her what?
Weak.
It's right there. Verse 27. And Laban said, verse 26, it must not be done in our country to give the younger before the firstborn. Fulfill her weak. He's talking about Leah. And we will give thee this also for the service which thou shalt serve with me. Yet, say it, church. Say it. How many years?
7 years.
Well, he just called a week 7 years. Didn't he? How many got it?
10.
How many saw that? Look at verse 9. Woo! And Jacob did so and fulfilled her week, or 7 years. Now go back to Daniel. Now I am starting to get somewhere. Go to your chart, ladies and gentlemen. Go to your chart. I'm going to help you. This is not as difficult as we make it sometimes. Now, Brother Kim, he said, fulfill her week. How many years was that? 7 years. Right? Church? Okay. Now, how many weeks did he set or determine for his people? 70. So we got 70 times what? 7. That's 490. But he said in 69 weeks, Messiah would be cut off. Right? Man, this is good stuff. That's 483 years. You multiply 69 times 7 and the Jewish calendar of 360 days, that is 173,880 days. Now, when did the clock start ticking? When did God's time clock start ticking? Do you know he told us? Whew. Oh, Lord. I love preaching. I love the Bible. I'm glad I got an inspired, infallible word of God. Yes. Now, notice verse 25. Know, therefore, and understand that from the going forth of the commandment to restore and to build Jerusalem, and unto the Messiah shall be 7 weeks and 62 weeks. All right. Now the question is, what was the date when they started the construction of Israel? I got it, church. Look at your chart. March 5th, 444 BC, under Artaxerxes, found in Nehemiah 2, 1 through 8. Here's what happened. Hey, Lois, here's what happened. God said, clock starts in March 5th, 444 BC. Clock starts. And it started. And it went for 173,880 days. Or 483 years until Jesus died on Calvary. Does it come real to you that in the fullness of time, God sent forth his son, made of woman, made under the law, ladies and gentlemen, the death of Christ was predetermined, prearranged from the foundation of the world, and Daniel's Bible and Daniel's book and Daniel's prophecy predicted it to the day.
Amen. That's it. Amen.
And then there's some today. I'm going to get this. I know this lesson is going to take more than 1 week. I'm going to get you this. There's some today that doubt the Bible. There's some today that says it's not God's word. They doubt the King James. That's not God's word. I'm going to tell you, it is God's word.
Amen.
Yes, sir.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. And I don't even have to have a Hebrew doctorate or a Greek doctorate to understand it.
Amen.
I got the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
And by the way, I'll debate you on that because there's a lot of them guys don't know what to talk about.
Right.
They ain't got about 25 different kind of Greeks. Good preaching, Reverend.
Amen.
When did he come into the city? March 30th, approximately. A.D. 33, the triumph of entry. Luke chapter 19, verses 28 through 40. We see Messiah come in and die on Calvary's cross. And then the Bible said, in verse 27, here's where the problem comes, Colton. That prince, the Antichrist, shall confirm the covenant with many for 1 week. That's the 70th week. That's the tribulation period. When God judges Israel, it's not about the church. Not about, I want to tell every one of you, you're not going to spend 1 minute
Amen.
In the tribulation period.
Amen.
Now, here's where it all gets fuzzy and confusing. We pretty well understand from the building of the temple, brother, to Calvary was 69 weeks, 483 years. We know that. But here's what God done. God stopped the clock. God stopped the clock. It's not running right now. God stopped the clock. And between the 69th week and the 70th week is the church period. Is that easy? Not too difficult. Because he told him in Malachi that I'm going to go to the Gentiles. God's got a Gentile bride. That's us. Those got some Jews in it too. Those that believe. Amen. Brother Leon, you're one of them. How many is this making some sense to you? I'll really make more sense to you next week. I'm just kind of laying a foundation. When I go to Revelation next week and then the following week to Matthew 24, I'm going to do away with all this false doctrine from the ice that's on YouTube. Now, how many understands that when he talks about 70 weeks, he's talking about 70 times 7 years, which is 490. And when you tabulate it from the time he started the building the temple to Calvary's cross, it's 483 years. Whew. Now, does it make sense now, Amy? In the fullness of time, God sent forth his son? Does that make sense now? In the fullness of time, God sent forth his son? At the end of the 69th week, he walks into Jerusalem or rides in Jerusalem on a donkey. And they had palm branches. They're praising in the first of the week and crucifying him at the end of the week. Or the middle of the week. In the fullness of time. Some of you, take your Bible serious. Somebody help me. In the fullness of time, God sent forth his son. Now here's what's got to happen. I'll deal with this a lot next week. I'll show you in the Bible where this is. But the next event, the clock stopped, Lois. It stopped. You want to know when how long it stopped for? You want to know how long? I don't know when, but they're going to be a last Gentile member of the Church of the Living God's going to get saved.
Amen.
And you know what's going to happen? We're going to be raptured. I'm going to explain that next week. I don't want to get ahead of myself. We're going to be raptured. And then here's what happens, church. I got to close. Oh, man. Here's what happens. He stopped the clock when Christ died. He's gathering his people, the church. That's you. And then what he's going to do, come back and get you before that 70th week. And then here's what happens. He starts the clock back. And it's 7 years of tribulation. And then at the end of the seventh year, now hold a minute, the second coming happens. And by the way, the rapture is not the second coming. The second coming is when he comes back to the earth with the church,
yes,
riding on white horses.
Amen.
And there'll be no more sorrow there.
Amen.
And there'll be no more pain there. And there'll be no more misunderstandings there. For the Lamb will be the light. And the Lamb, his vesture will be dipped in blood. And his name will be King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Somebody help me. He's going to come back. I'll give you more of this next week. He's going to come back. And we're going to have a marriage supper. And by the way, Hyman Appleman said it. They won't say grace till I get there. And guess what? Church. How many of you know you're saved? Raise your hand. You're the church. Church. You're going to go on a 1,000-year honeymoon. When I got married, I didn't have a honeymoon. How many of y'all got married didn't have a honeymoon? I don't want to be left alone. Some of you, God bless you. I ain't had no money for no honeymoon. But one of these days, he's going to rapture me up. I'm going to sit down with him and drink that communion new in his kingdom. And then I'm going to have a 1,000-year honeymoon and a 1,000-year literal millennial reign. And we'll reign with Christ. You ain't going to do it unless you've been saved. And next week, I'll explain all this real well. I'll just give you an overview tonight. Bow your head with me. I'm done. I want to make sure there's everybody say, how many knows you're saved for sure? Raise your hand high. Oh, and hold them up there. Knows you're saved. All right, good. I thank everybody. If there's somebody here not sure you're saved, raise your hand. You won't be ready for the rapture if you're not sure you're saved. I think everybody is. Stand with me. We'll sing a verse of song, then dismiss. Glory to God. Glad to be home. Woo! Next week, I'm going to give you the Daniel's 70 weeks. Then I'm going to show you that peace pact, that covenant the Antichrist makes in the book of Revelation. And then the following week, I'm going to show you in Matthew 24. And don't let anybody tell you Matthew 24 is talking about the church. It's not.
Amen.
Okay? It's not talking about the rapture. It's talking about the second coming.
Amen.
Father, thank you for our time together. Lord, thank you for your word. It blessed me tonight. Heaven and earth shall pass away, but thy word shall never pass away. Hallelujah. There might be somebody here so discouraged, been battling the devil. Help them know that they can stand on your word. The answers to their problems are in your word. And we'll praise you in Jesus' name for his sake. Amen. God bless you. Good night.